I'm speaking this morning on Peter, and the sermon series this month was The Imposter. If you look at one particular place in Peter's life, maybe a couple, you can say, was he really real? You know, he had some failures. And but Peter, to me, larger than life in the Bible, along with some a lot of other people and characters in the Bible, a fisherman turned into a fisher of men. Matthew, Mark, and Luke depict him as the first of two disciples that Jesus called and said, come follow me. Peter, the rock. Peter, outspoken one. The first to declare Jesus to be the Christ, the Son of the living God. Peter, seemingly unafraid, or so it seemed. Peter, he could talk a good game, but could he actually play it out to the end? Peter, he was a water walker. Peter, he was a sleepyhead during his time in the Garden of Gethsemane with Jesus, and he was asked to stay awake, and he fell asleep. And Jesus checked on him, and he was falling back asleep. Peter, the sleepyhead. Peter, quick with a sword. He was one, we read in John 18, where he was the one that cut off the ear of the temple servant. And I've always wondered, did he pull it and go up, or pull it and go down, without hitting the juggler? How did he do that? So, but quick with a sword. Peter, the denier of Jesus. Yet, he becomes the preeminent leader, apostle of the disciples. Wish we had time to go into all the scriptures concerning Peter, particularly in Acts, where he gives a speech and 3,000 come to the Lord. Oh my goodness. I'm going to look at four aspects of Peter's life this morning, some very quickly. And if you have the mind, I ask you to go back through the scriptures. As Pastor Phil says, we believe vertical. From Genesis to Revelation, that the gospel is in there. The gospel of Jesus Christ. From Genesis to Revelation, the Bible puts everything together. But we're going to look at Peter's call to follow. We're going to look at him in recognizing Jesus as Messiah. We're going to look at his denial of Jesus. And then we're going to spend some time looking at his restoration and reconciliation to Jesus. Some say his reinstatement of his faith to Jesus. So if you will, turn with me to Matthew chapter 4. And if you're new to the Bible, Matthew is the first book of the New Testament. It's probably about two-thirds through your Bible. Matthew chapter 4, we're going to pick up at verse 18. And all my scriptures are from, it may be a little bit different on the screen, but I like the 1978 NIV version. I've been in that one for many, many years. As Jesus was walking beside the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon, called Peter, and his brother Andrew. They were casting a net into the lake, for they were fishermen. Come follow me, Jesus said, and I will make you fishers of men. At once they left their nets and followed him. Pretty straightforward scripture here. We don't know if they had seen Jesus around or anything like that in the area. I know there's one gospel that depicts or tells that Jesus had already been speaking in the synagogue. So I don't know if they had heard about him or what, but they obviously sensed something uniquely different about Jesus. At once they ceased their work and began to follow. That was their livelihood. That was their living. They just dropped the nets and began to follow. Left the workplace. Can you imagine doing that today? Just dropping it all. So my question is, has Jesus called you to follow him? has Jesus called you to follow him? Let's go on in Matthew chapter 16. Go ahead and turn there. And now this is after Peter's been following Jesus for probably 2 years, maybe a little longer. It's about the beginning of the third year of Jesus' ministry. And so we're going to pick up at verse 13, Matthew 16, verse 13. When Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say the Son of Man is?" They replied, "Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and still others Jeremiah or one of the prophets." "But what about you?" he asked. "Who do you say I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." Jesus replied, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by man, but by my Father in heaven." Peter, the mouthpiece of the disciples, just quick with an answer always. Without hesitation, he blurts out for all to hear. And Jesus said that it was an anointed answer because it came from the Father. The Father revealed that to Peter. Second question, do you recognize Jesus as Messiah, the anointed one, the Son of the living God? Has he called you to follow him? And do you recognize him as Messiah, as the Christ? All four Gospels tell of Peter's denial of Jesus. Matthew 26, Mark 14, John 18, but we're going to be in Luke 22 and read a couple of different scripture verses there. And this, the Last Supper has taken place. And Jesus is talking to his disciples. And he says this to Simon Peter, in verse 31, Luke 22, verse 31. "Simon, Simon, Satan has asked to sift you as wheat. But I have prayed for you, Simon, that your faith may not fail. And when you have returned, and when you have turned back, strengthen your brothers." Verse 33. "But he replied, Lord, I am ready to go with you to prison and to death." Jesus answered, "I tell you, Peter, before the rooster crows today, you will deny three times that you know me." Many have read that scripture a lot about Peter denying Jesus. So let's go there. Chapter 22, verse 54. And this is in the Garden of Gethsemane where they are seizing Jesus. "Then seizing him, they led him away and took him into the house of the high priest. Peter followed at a distance. But when they had kindled a fire in the middle of the courtyard and had sat down together, Peter sat down with them. A servant girl saw him seated there in the firelight. She looked closely at him and said, 'This man was with him.' But he denied it. 'Woman, I don't know him,' he said. A little later, someone else saw him and said, 'You also are one of them.' 'Man, I am not,' Peter replied. About an hour later, another asserted, 'Certainly this fellow was with him, for he is a Galilean.' Peter replied, 'Man, I don't know what you're talking about.' Just as he was speaking, the rooster crowed." Three times he denied Jesus. Verse 61, to me an important verse here. "The Lord turned and looked straight at Peter. Then Peter remembered the word the Lord had spoken to him. 'Before the rooster crows today, you will disown me three times.' And he went outside and wept bitterly." That was a bold statement by Peter when reality was spoken by Jesus. Jesus is telling him he's going to be sifted as wheat. And Peter said, no. I'm ready to go to prison and to death with you. But Peter was sifted. And I want to talk about that whole process of being sifted, because it happens in our lives. And being sifted means being put through a sieve to shake things out. It was a process of wheat, and it can be a process in our life where you're separating that which is good from that which is bad. Or another way, taking out those things that are unworthy from those things that are worthy, and sifting out maybe what is unhealthy from things that are healthy for us. My understanding from research and just references is that the sifting was the last step in the process of wheat. There were actually two other processes before that, the threshing and the winnowing, and we'll talk about that. But even before that, you've got to get the wheat out of the field. Okay? So they do that with a sickle. They come along and they're cutting the wheat as low as they can get. They're cutting the wheat, and then they're bundling it up in a tight bundle, and they're stacking them. So I'm asking, have you ever felt like all of a sudden you've just been cut off at the knees before? That you've been tied up, that you've been bundled, that there's nowhere to go. Life will do that sometimes, and it's usually part of a sifting process in our lives. The next step is the threshing. So let's take a little bit closer look at that one. Threshing is when they either, those bundles are taken to the threshing floor and they're laid down, and either animals tromp on them, or they have what they call threshing sledges, which are big rolling devices. They would roll over it, and it would roll over time and time again. And what they were doing, they were breaking the kernel of wheat out of the husk, because the husk is hard, protecting the kernel. So they would do that time and time again, either with animals or with threshing sledges. When my wife Sarah and I were ministering in India, and in some of the villages and even some of the largest cities, you see people, particularly women, standing on the side of the road with these bundles of wheat, and they throw them out in the pavement. And then the cars would roll over them, or the little tuk-tuks, which we were in, which is just a little three-wheel vehicle, and you crammed in like sardines. But they would roll over that wheat, and they were having the husk broken off of the kernels of wheat. And if you look back, you would see they would gather it again and wait, and then another vehicle come, and they would throw it down again and roll over and roll over and roll over until the kernel came out. Ever felt trampled upon in your life? In everyone's life, there are things about us that need to be knocked loose or broken away. The winnowing. Was done by tossing the wheat at that step, up in the air. And usually during harvest time, there was a wind blowing. I may be wrong, but I think it was the east wind. And when you throw it up off the threshing floor, the chaff blew away, and what fell down was the kernel to the threshing floor for you to gather. And you lift it up, and more would blow away. You lift it up, and more would blow away. You lift it up, and more of the wheat would fall to the floor. Time and time again. Have you ever felt tossed about in your life time and time again? In everyone's life, there are things that need to be blown away. Everyone's life. And now the sifting that Jesus said Peter would go through. And the sifting was, the wheat was gathered and it was put into a sieve. And actually what's taking place is you're shaking that sieve. And there's little holes in there. And what stays in is the pure kernel of wheat. But what falls out is all this unwanted little particle still clinging to that piece of wheat. And so you shake that kernel. And what was left was what was usable. Have you ever felt just totally shaken to your core sometimes in your walk, in your life? In everyone's life, even the smallest of things that are not of God need to be shifted out of our life. It's that sifting that takes those small little things, those nagging little things out of our lives that don't belong there because they're not of Him. Amen? Things that are clinging to us that don't belong there. I wanted to explain all that for us to see that in order for Peter to come to that place of being sifted, he had to go through all the other processes too. You don't just take wheat and put it in the sieve and start shifting. It has to be trampled on. It has to be tossed about to get down to the pure kernel that they were seeking to be used to store as food, to be sent to the miller for grinding and for consumption. I believe as the up-and-coming, preeminent leader of the apostles, Peter went through it all, the whole process. And by the time he got through the sifting process, he had become, to me, as a broken bread or poured out wine. He was 100% devoted to Jesus as his Lord and Savior. That he had been emptied of himself and filled with Jesus. Everything else that was not supposed to be there was sifted out. Peter was an uncovered man. Everything about him had been exposed. And you know what? Jesus did not reject him. Because as Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians 13, love keeps no records of wrong. Aren't you grateful for that? A little bit closer look at that verse 61 in Luke 22. The Lord turned and looked straight at Peter. Some translations say the Lord turned and gazed at Peter. That's pretty much saying they locked eyes. They saw each other in that moment when that rooster was crowing. And to me, it wasn't a look of, I told you so. I've had a look before from my wife. And it's usually, you need to stop, you're digging a hole here. I had a look from my father, my older sister and younger brother too. And that certain look, you just knew, whatever you're doing, you better stop. You know, that look. That wasn't the look that Jesus gave Peter. It wasn't a look of condemnation. It wasn't a look of, I told you so. To me, it was a look of compassion. It was a look of hope. It was a look that said, it's all right. You're going to be okay. Remember, I said I was going to pray for you, and you were going to get through this stronger, and then you're going to be able to help your brothers? To me, that was the look. Remember what I said about this, Peter. I'm there for you, no matter what. It was that kind of look. The truth of Peter's life had been revealed. The truth that in his own strength he was nothing. Truth that without Jesus he was nothing. And that's the same with us. A while back, Pastor was preaching out of John 15 about abiding in Jesus. We have to stay connected. We have to stay connected. We can do nothing on our own. It's only through Him It's only through Him. Everything about Peter was revealed. The truth that Jesus knew him inside out and upside down. And the truth that Jesus would always love him. And we're going to get to that. Please know that there will be times in your life when you will be sifted. And maybe more than once. I know that's happened to me. Time and again, something that God said, this doesn't belong in you anymore. We're going to sift it out. And I may feel trampled. I may feel beaten up. I may feel shaken tremendously. But it's for good. It's for good. It's for a purpose to help strengthen us and for us to strengthen our brothers and sisters. I'm convinced, because I've been in many of these situations of being sifted, that God uses all types of situations and circumstances to sift us. Friendships will sift you. Marriage will sift you. Finances will sift you. Politics will sift you. That one I know personally. I ran for a local office many years ago. Won, but I tell you what, there was a sifting process there in the midst of governing. Ministry will sift you. Serving will sift you. Pastoring will sift you. Being a father or mother will sift you. Your workplace will sift you. Sickness will sift you. We got a testimony about that with Sarah and I. I don't have time to go into it, but sickness will sift you. Tragedy will sift you. And we could go on and on. You probably have your own example of what you feel like, man, I've been trampled on. I've been cut down. I've been trampled on. I've been crushed. I've been shaken. But at the end of the sifting process, God does not say, you're no good. I can't use you. It's just the opposite. It's just the opposite. Turn with me to John chapter 21. We're going to be at verse 15. Now, this is after the resurrection. Peter has said, I'm going fishing. And about six of his fellow disciples jump in the boat with him. They fish all night. Come morning, they're looking toward the shore, and there's someone sitting on the shore. And he says, did you catch anything? They said, no. Been out all night, didn't catch anything. And he said, throw your net on the right side of the boat and you will catch. And they did. And they started bringing it in. There were so many fish they couldn't bring them all in. And it was John that recognized, it's the Lord. And Peter wraps himself up and he jumps out of that boat, swimming the shore. I shared at the first service that reminded me of Forrest Gump when he saw Lieutenant Dan. You know, he's in that shrimp boat. Lieutenant Dan! And then, I mean, he's just diving in, swimming. He's swimming to his friend. See, Jesus has already called his, you're my friends now. But he's also the Lord and Savior. So Peter swims to shore. And after they cook the fish and they're eating together, we're going to pick up at verse 15 here. John chapter 21. When they had finished eating, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of Jonah, do you truly love me more than these? Yes, Lord, he said, you know that I love you. Jesus said, feed my lambs. Again, Jesus said, Simon, son of John, do you truly love me? He answered, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. Jesus said, take care of my sheep. The third time he said to him, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Peter was hurt because Jesus asked him the third time, "Do you love me?" He said, "Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you." There's not a single thing that the Lord does not know about us. We're not keeping any secrets from him whatsoever. There's not a part of us he doesn't know about. Are we following Jesus? Do we recognize him as Messiah? Accepted him as our Lord and Savior? And now, do we really and truly love him? Because, see, each one of those things, when he asked, "Do you love me?" It didn't matter what Peter did. The Lord gave Peter an assignment. Feed my lambs. Take care of my sheep. Feed my sheep. And he does that with us. No matter what we've been through, on the other side of it, if we truly love him, he's got an assignment for each and every one of us to fulfill. We just have to hear him. Our past does not define us. Peter's past did not define him. Who we might pretend to be does not define us. Who we might have deceived, who we might have hurt, who we might have injured does not define us. What we might have promised and didn't fulfill a promise, that doesn't define us. What defines us is our relationship with Jesus and in Jesus. With Jesus and in Jesus. Who we are in him. We're loved, we're redeemed, we're sanctified, we're forgiven, we're blessed with the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus because the blood shed on the cross. And who he is in us. Our Lord and Savior, yes. Our life and breath here and now, yes. Leading us through his Holy Spirit that he sent, yes. The living Word speaking to us. And he's our life and breath eternally. I ask the worship team to start coming back up. You know, speaking for myself, and I think I can say I or we are not the same person we were for me 40 years ago. Some of you may not be there yet. That's fine. I'm not the same person I was 30 years ago or 20 years ago or 10 years ago or 5 or 1. I'm not even the same person I was 6 months ago or a month ago or even last week or yesterday or even before this service began. See, identity in Christ changes us year by year, month by month, week by week, and he changes us moment by moment. Listen to these words from a sifted Peter. 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 8 and 9. Finally, all of you live in harmony with one another. I don't know if he's in here, but Chad Vance gave a really good word to Man Church the other Sunday. Living in harmony. Tremendous. Be sympathetic. Love as brothers. Be compassionate and humble. Do not repay evil for evil. And this is from the man that took the sword and cut off the ear. He's been sifted. Do not repay evil with evil or insult with insult, but with blessing. Because of this you were called, so that you may inherit a blessing. And then in 2 Peter chapter 3, verses 8 and 9. But do not forget this one thing, dear friends. With the Lord, a day is like 1,000 years. And 1,000 years are like a day. In that process of being sifted, of being threshed, of being tossed about, of being shaken. And I can say this, there's been days when I've walked through that process and I'm thinking, will this never end? It seems like it's going on forever. Like 1,000 years. One day can seem like 1,000 years. But I also know that after the process, after that sifting, after whatever it was needed to be shaken off, and I'm moving on, I look back and it seems like that was 1,000 years ago. Because moment by moment, we're being changed. Verse 9, the Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some understand slowness. He is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. Words of a man who had been sifted and was better because of the process, just like Jesus said he would be. Peter didn't get there right away. We won't get there right away. But he came to know who he was in Jesus and who Jesus was in him. Peter went through that process and came out stronger. Because we have a Savior seated right next to the Father interceding for us. Just as he's prayed with Peter, he's praying for each and every person here, whatever it is you're going through. Does your life feel like it's being sifted right now? Maybe you're in the middle of the process. Maybe you feel like it's just beginning. Know this, Jesus is and always will be with you through the process and waiting to be right there with you after the process, because he has something for you. He has an assignment for you. There's not a person here today whom the Lord does not desire to have a personal relationship with. No matter where you've been, what you've done, his desire is that your identity be in him. One last statement here. Our personality, your personality, your unique personality was created for his kingdom purposes, just like Peter's personality. Strong, boastful, no Lord, yes Lord, I love you, Lord. Was created for God's kingdom purposes. There's not a person in this room that's not created for God's kingdom purposes. Close, I just want to pray. If you're going through some of those processes, you don't have to raise your hand. God knows who you are. I just want to pray for strength doing that, just as Peter did. I just want to, whatever it may be. So can we do that? Father, you know all things. There's no one sitting here that they're going through something or experiencing something or that you're surprised by. Father, whether it's the threshing or the shaking or the tumbling around or whatever it may be, Lord, I pray that you touch each heart here. For Lord, you are interceding for them right now, that as they get through whatever process they're in, they'll be stronger for it, for themselves, for your kingdom purposes, for their brother and their sisters, for them to show forth courage in an area that maybe they can help someone else walk through a difficult situation. It's not for naught. We love you, Lord. And Lord, we say, whatever it is you have for us, Lord, let us be able to do for your kingdom as you would have us do for your kingdom.